The history of the Byzantine Empire is often overshadowed by the Western Roman Empire. Yet among the most magnificent rulers of the realm, Justinian, Constantine, Heraclius, or Basil II, we have to highlight an emperor who may have not conquered the most territories or built the greatest monuments, but managed to restore much of the former mightiness. After the defeat of Manzikert and death of Emperor Romanus, Michael VII was crowned the emperor. His incompetent administration worsened the state of the empire. He was unable to defend Byzantine Anatolia. The general Nikephoros Botanides joined in open revolt against the emperor. Botanides took Constantinople and he was crowned Basileios. By then, the Seljuk Sultanate had taken most of Western Anatolia. Under the pressure, Botanides abdicated on Alexios Komnenos, who had previously taken control of the capital. On Easter Sunday, 4 April 1081, Alexios received the imperial crown. He was married to Irene Doukas, thus securing the support of the most influential family in the empire, and the clergy too. Alexios knew the situation of the empire was dire and grievous. With the loss of the fertile regions of Western Anatolia, the empire had lost its main breadbasket, and both the Seljuk Sultanate and the Normans, the latter led by Robert Guiscard, immediately threatened the empire. After pillaging the countryside, Robert quickly pushed to the Requiem. To their dismay, the Venetians, who had signed a commercial treaty with the Romans, saw the trade routes threatened, and they declared war on the Norman duchy. Alexios marched at the head of the army to relieve the city. In October 1081, he confronted the Norman army. However, the exhausted Varangian guard was no match to the Norman cavalry, and his charge disbanded the Byzantine army. Nevertheless, Alexios bribed Henry IV of the Holy Roman Empire to attack the Normans. Thus, Robert left the command of his campaign to his audacious son, Bohemond. Bohemond took advantage of the Byzantine weakness and he advanced deeper into Greece. Yet, Bohemond was defeated and forced to retire to Italy. The death of Robert Guiscard in 1085 meant a tacit peace and allowed the Byzantines to turn their attention north. The Pechenegs, a Turkic tribe, had crossed the Danube River. After 5 years of constant struggle, Alexios recurred to one of the oldest and most effective strategies when facing nomadic tribes. Turn one against the other. Alexios negotiated an alliance with the Cumans. Even though they did not have a particular quarrel with the Pechenegs, they sent their army south to fight them. In April 1091, the Pechenek army was destroyed. With the Pechenegs out of the way, Alexios had increased his popularity and he could now try to reconquer the eastern territories. Nevertheless, he knew it would not be possible to consolidate the gains without assistance from the Catholic Western countries. The Byzantine ambassadors met the Pope in Piacenza in 1095, and, hoping to reunite the two Christian branches, he later called a crusade. Thanks to the Crusaders, the Sultanate of Rome was severely enfeebled, and Alexios prepared a campaign to recover Western Anatolia. John Doukas, brother-in-law of the Emperor, was able to recover in a dazzling campaign from 1097 to 1099 all of Western Anatolia and, afterwards, all of the northern coast. This region was vastly fertile and was vital to feed the population of Constantinople and the army. Consequently, by the end of his reign, Alexios had confined the Turks to the center of the peninsula. Regarding the economy, Alexios revaluated the coin and significantly improved the financial situation of the empire. The consequences of the crisis in the late 11th century, the Byzantine Empire, are countless. It gave way to the Crusades and opened the gates of Europe to the Turks, forever changing the political outlook of the Middle East and Eastern Europe. Furthermore, the stability of the following years gave rise to a new golden age in Byzantine art. With this in mind, the Komnene dynasty wouldn't be able to return to their previous status quo. From then on, Byzantium was forced to keep losing territories and influence to the emerging powers, such as the Bulgarians, the Serbs, the Phoenicians, or the Ottomans. Particularly, Constantinople couldn't be saved from being sacked by the Crusaders in 1204. All considered, however, it's worth mentioning that, even in the middle of the collapse, there may still be a flame of hope and perseverance. The Byzantines knew it was never too late to try to make a stand, that even in the darkest of times, they still grew.